Everybody, welcome. If you are just joining us on Zoom or Facebook, my name is Shabaka Kamban, and I'm the director of the Crossroads Freedom Project. And of course, I work in the Emancipation Support Committee as part of the Education and Outreach Projects of the committee. And today we are having the second installment of the Kwame Ture Memorial Lecture Series. And of course, the Kwame Ture Memorial Lecture Series is one important part of the Pan-African Festival, the International Pan-African Festival, TT, which commemorates emancipation every year. This year, it's a very, very special time for this. Let me just say that this particular event, this virtual event, is brought to you with the support of the UWI Open Campus and the Ministry of Community Development, Culture, and the Arts. And of course, we're having this event this year at a very special time. We are witnessing what can be described as a global revolt against white supremacy and systemic racism, where people have come to the recognition of the damage that these things play, or the damage that these things do in the lives of people of color all over the world. This rapid shift in popular consciousness has led to protests in over 60 countries, including Trinidad and Tobago, under the banner of Black Lives Matter, targeting both the historical antecedents and the contemporary manifestations of racial privilege and disadvantage, and anything that would bolster and perpetuate racial injustice. So in the midst of this global revolt, we are having this particular event. And of course, this event is really very relevant because this year the theme is 1970, remembering, reconnection, and recommitment. And 1970, exactly 50 years ago, was the very last time that you had that kind of shift in global consciousness in the world around these very same issues. And with us today are some members of some people who featured in that revolution from a group called the National Organization for Revolutionary Students, NORS, the National Organization of Revolutionary Students. Now, most of you will not be familiar with NORS, but NORS was a very important part of 1970. It's the youth arm of the National Joint Action Committee, the younger people who were involved in the struggle. And we're going to be talking to them to connect the past to the present, to see what we can learn from them about what's happening today. But first, we're going to go to them and to find out more about NORS. Today, we're going to get that chance to explore the National Organization of Revolutionary Students from 1970, exactly 50 years ago. Welcome to the panelists. And of course, with us is Josanne Leonard, daughter of Winston Leonard, one of the founding members of the National Joint Action Committee and one of the revered elders, veterans of the 1970 Black Power Revolution. She's an independent consultant and a founding member of the National Organization of Revolutionary Students. Along with Sister Josanne Leonard is Sister Aisha Mutope Johnson. And Aisha is an attorney and counselor and another founding member of the National Organization of Revolutionary Students. Along with them, we have two brothers, Brother Martin Abu Alexander, who's the director today of the Caribbean Historical Society, and former chair of the National Organization of Revolutionary Students, and as well, Chi Kamose, Brother Chi Kamose, who is a change management officer, the Ministry of Social Development and Family Services, and also was a foundation member of the National Organization of Revolutionary Students. Welcome all. Sister Josanne, can I start with you? I'd like to ask you to introduce this audience who probably never heard of NORS to the National Organization of Revolutionary Students.
Thank you very much, Shabaka, and I'd like to say a very special good afternoon, early evening to all of the viewers and listeners on this Kwame Kwame Ture lecture series commemorating 50 years of the Black Power Revolution as part of its theme of emancipation celebrations this year. I think you kind of did the introduction for us, that very lengthy introduction in terms of locating the historical context, Shabaka. But I think if I would lead off very quickly, first of all, I'd like to say a very special hello to Aisha Matupe Johnson, who, unlike Martin, and she, who I would see and coalesce with from time to time, she's been living in the United States for many decades, but she was my writing partner, so to speak, during that period of our students. I think we have a lot to say, and not all can be said in this one discussion, but I'm very happy that we are able to locate a sense of the younger people of that time, meaning the younger generation, those of us who were attending secondary school, essentially. In other words, we were not part of the university group, of the labor movement, of the clergy, of the all of these sort of other activists who were actually around in that time. Because of course, while NJAC emerged as the leadership organization, it was a time of tremendous awareness and consciousness, sparked too by a lot of what was going on in the world, but a lot of what was going on in the Caribbean as well. So we kind of developed those. But I think what is pretty significant, and I would not want to hog the mic, so to speak, is to actually locate the awareness and consciousness of young people. And our age group would have been anywhere between 14 to 18 years of age, being in the secondary school system and being very much a part, not of just NOAS, but very much a part of the wider social movement through different groups. And of course, in my case, and Aisha will speak for herself and Martin and others, there would have been the National Joint Action Committee. So I think it's a very timely conversation, and I'm happy for the occasion to spark the conversation about locating this in our contemporary history.
Indeed, indeed. Now, Josanne, you would have been the daughter of Winston Leonard, one of the founding members of the National Joint Action Committee, a man who had played an important part in the labor struggle in that period. So we get a sense of where your consciousness would have come from. Anybody who would have met Uncle Winston and had a chance to rap with him would understand how his children and even his grandchildren would have a certain type of consciousness. But let me bring in Sister Aisha Mutupe now, and Brother Chika Mose, and followed by Brother Abu Alexander, to tell me a little bit about how they got involved, where that consciousness came from, what were the things that sparked them to become part of a movement that was really Caribbean wide, that had connections to the international scene. Sister Aisha.
Thank you, Brother Shabaka. And it's a great pleasure to be here with people I have not seen in many years, who helped me form my ideas and inspired me too, to be part of a movement that I've never given up on. And I often say, I don't know where mine came from, except that truth is truth. And I was raised with the understanding that many raised us with 60, 70 years ago, you know, that some are better than others, that we have some better classes than others. You look down on certain people, and if they are poor, they deserve to be poor, and they won't find their way because they don't want to work. And I woke up one day around age 16 and realized that it was all a great big lie, and that people everywhere stand in their own truth in the same way and happen to have circumstances for any number of reasons that lead them to live the lives they lead. And because it just so happened that wealth and money and status did not seem to mean that much to me, it became an easy thing for me to let go of the notion of status and class consciousness and the power and authority that apparently comes with that, and to want to live in the truth that all of us, in my view, and there are a few things I say should about, but yeah, all ought to embrace, which is the basic truth that we're all equal, whether it's race, class, socioeconomic status, it does not matter. And once we start from that place, we find any number of reasons to seek out others, to support others, regardless of their particular status or situation. So that is what drove me, I believe, at the time.
Yeah, let me just quickly remind our viewers, those of you participating on Zoom can use the chat option to submit your questions. And those of you on Facebook, of course, can leave your questions there. And of course, we'll try our best to answer them. Let me bring in Brother Abu, as he was termed in 1970s. His real name is still Martin Alexander. But Brother Abu, talk to me a little bit. I mean, when we think about 1970, we think about a revolution that really tried to give form and substance to our independence. Can you connect that that local circumstance with what was happening internationally at the time for us? And how that affected your consciousness? Because I want to get a sense of what you were thinking as a young man and how you ended up marching and participating and becoming a part of that historical event.
Okay, the international actions that were taking place in the world at that time, where you would have things like the Vietnam War, the independence movements in Africa and other places, of course, were things that were regular discussion in my home, in that I came from a family that were principals and teachers, so that they had a keen interest in what was taking place in the world and also locally. As a result of hearing the discussions at home around the dining table and so forth, I had a certain amount of awareness as a young school student. And then, of course, what happened in 1970, where things crystallized on the local stage, it all blended in with what was taking place internationally, because today we know quite well, and we see it, that it is that system of colonialism that had established itself throughout the New World by Europe and, of course, Africa, Asia. And people suffer from the same forms of repression, whether economic, spiritual, cultural, they're all in the same bag, so that it struck a note because we are in the same bag in Trinidad. So my activism started as a young fellow when I got the chance to slip away and join some of the demonstrations and so forth. Of course, at that time I was 15, but 1 year later in 1971 at Woodbrook Secondary, everything crystallized. And of course, I was there in Woodbrook Secondary at in the heart of where everything, where North is concerned, the students erupted.
Yeah, right. Let me bring in Brother Chi Kamose. Welcome, my brother.
Thank you very much.
Right, tell us, Brother Chi. I'm gonna get straight to this question of I'm just looking at the panel now, and I'm seeing Sister Josan, who is of Indian descent. I'm seeing Brother Abu and Sister Aisha, African descent. And you appear to be Chinese descent. You've taken the name Chikamose. I know that's not your original name. Tell us how you, as someone who perhaps of mixed heritage with that Chinese background, found that spark to become part of what we now know as the Black Power Revolution.
First, let me say that I reclaimed my name. So while people may not be my original name, I reclaimed my name. I want to set that straight, right? The other thing too is that my involvement within the Black Power concept would have stretched back in my memory from 1962. At that time, we got independence in Trinidad and Tobago. And I knew the two main people in my mind were Eric Williams and Solomon Hochoy. And at that time, I wanted desperately that Eric Williams had more power than Solomon Hochoy, simply because Eric Williams was black. Where that came from, I don't know. But that I remember clearly thinking about, and there was no discussion about any black power, African Indian thing in my, I grew up in an adopted home in an African family, and there was no question of that within the family. So in that context, I find that a little strange, but that's the reality. The other thing too is my involvement in the black power movement came because of the kind of wretched existence we had as poor people, where I lived in both Mova, then I went to Belmont, then I went to Lavantil, then I went to Carnage, and back to Mova now. Our existence, you know, being in that wretched kind of way, not all of us, most of us, because we have the well-to-do, and then we have those of us who, like myself, many days we had nothing to eat. And like I said on countless occasions, lots of times I went to school without any sugar water in my stomach. So that's where my involvement, you know, came in. And I also want to contextualize the whole concept of Black. Lots of us in the society think of Black as African only. And that's a mistake. I remember being heckled about Black Chinese African, Chinese Chinese African, and that kind of thing. That was like showing water and dog back in any case. Yeah. However, we need to understand that Black encompasses, once you are not white, you are Black. So our Indian brothers are Black, our Chinese brothers are Black. And let me refer you all to this movie on Netflix called The Legend of Bruce Lee. And you'll see where Bruce Lee speaks about being discriminated against because he was colored, right? And you know, so that's the context I want to put at it. And also the whole question of the struggle continues from the first time part of my ancestors was captured and brought across into slavery, right? And up to today, we are still not free. We may think we are free, but mentally, those chains are still there, and we have lots of barriers we are yet to overcome, or hurdles, I should say, we are yet to overcome. And we need to try to understand, how are we going to get over those hurdles? And from time to time, the whole question of how the struggle evolves and the new strategies to be free, you know, that has also evolved.
Right. So you speak about your own context and the way that your own experience of life, brought you to the point where you felt that you would want to be part of something that would demand change, part of a movement that would demand change. But what for you would have been the trigger for you to join NOS, the National Organization of Revolutionary Students? And when did you become involved?
I was a student. I stayed in Belmont Secondary and I watched, and I mean, I didn't have the energy nor the permission from Granny and they to go and join any march. They would have none of that. But I stayed in school at times and I watched Desmond Granger, Kirkland, Paul, and a number of other students from Belmont Secondary talk. And I listened, you know, and I found myself being motivated by them, not just by them only, but by the reality of the conditions under which we live as a people, you know. And so it was easy for me to merge, let me call it that, merge into the struggle rather than join the struggle. Because the struggle is part of my life and will continue to be part of my life even after I die, because until we are free, struggle, according to the South Africans, a luta continua.
Indeed. We're going to take a quick break. We're going to wrap up there. We've had some very interesting opening remarks from everyone. I think it was great that we were able to touch on that whole question of Blackness and the meaning of Blackness in the context of the Black Power Revolution of 1970 in this early segment here. We're going to take a quick break. And when we come back, we're going to get deeper into this question of the meaning of the National Organization of Revolutionary Students, what it was like, what the experience of it was like, what were the things that the causes that this group struggled for, and so on. What part did they play in the Black Power Revolution? And then, of course, we're going to start talking about what's happening today. Say it now. To the second edition of the Kwame Ture Memorial Lecture Series. And of course, the theme this year, 1970, Remembering, Reconnection, and Recommitment. And we are talking to members, foundation members of the National Organization of Revolutionary Students, NOS. And they, of course, were sort of the youth arm of the National Joint Action Committee in 1970. And of course, in 1970, the National Joint Action Committee was the umbrella organization that embraced all the groups that came to be at the forefront of that period of upheaval. So let's talk quickly before we get into to major questions. I just want everybody to tell me which one of the elders of the 1970 Black Power movement for you, each person, was the most charismatic orator. I just want to ask that question to the younger people, because I mean, here you guys were coming into the movement. Who was the orator that most among the elders that most? I mean, I was able to hear. I have recollections of McCandle Daga. I have recollections of Winston Leonard. I have recollections of my father and Kwesi, Lasana Kwesi, speaking from that period. Can anybody tell me anybody or any speech they remember from that period that would have fired them, that fired their their revolutionary imagination in the period?
If I may jump in, I think there were any number of people who had that kind of impact in terms of the marches, the demonstrations, the speeches, etc. And because my own position was that, you know, 1970 wasn't an acquired taste. So that listening to people like George Weeks, for example, from the OWTU, and Nuevo Diaz and my own dad, and there were so many. So I don't know, for me personally, that there's one definitive orator. And I think as well that we have to be very careful about just focusing simply on quote unquote leaders, because there were so many people in various groups having their impact before NJAC emerged as the structured kind of entity that led, because their people were coming from many different organizations and so on. And in fact, labor was from the late 60s into the early 70s, labor was very much carrying the banner of change and revolutionary change. And they were very fiery men and women from the labor movement. Joe Young comes to mind, as I said, George Weeks, Clive Nunes and others. So I think it's a mixed bag. I don't think I can say there's any one single person that stand out. But if I want to have a biased view, I would say that my father was a phenomenal platform speaker.
Let me just get a quick comment from everybody before we get into the issues that Noah's tackled in that period. Brother Kamose?
I spent considerable time by McCandle Daga. And so one might feel as yes, he was the one. But like Jotan said, there are a number of other people. And at times we tend to place emphasis on the leadership. So at Kaffir Kambo and McCandle Daga, Kwesi, as somebody pointed out just now and so on.
Yeah.
But on the block talking with people and the comments they would make, the perspectives they would share, that were not platform perspective, but they were perspective of life down on the ground. Where sometimes the leadership don't reach in tangible ways, let me call it that, right? And people down on the ground would give you some perspectives, would give you some quotations out of your own head, not anything they read anywhere, just the way they translate what the experiences were. And those are some of the things that drew me. That's why I said, in this struggle, I will always be there. I've never considered myself outside of on the ground. I've always been on the ground.
Let me ask another question then before we get into to what Noah's was doing in that period. One of the Caribbean intellectuals who is featured prominently, who has re-emerged in this period here of this global revolt, is Frantz Fanon. First, his comment, "I can't breathe, I revolt simply because I can't breathe." And then, of course, his directive that imperialism leaves behind germs of rot, which we must clinically detect and remove, not just from our minds, but from our lands as well, sort of pointing people towards monuments to racism and white supremacy. So, but Frantz Fanon was also a critical intellectual figure back in 1970. Anybody want to comment on how we have that that parallel between what was happening then and what's happening now?
I'll come in at this point, if I may.
Yes, my brother.
Franz Fanon, of course, was a psychiatrist, psychologist. And he dealt with an aspect of the problem that many people up to this day shy away from. So it is very easy for people to deal with the economic aspect and so forth. But one of the most challenging aspects of the problem that we have are the psychological scars. Of course, we know now it is quite common to hear people speak about, you know, stress disorders and so forth after people have returned from the war. But what many people do not understand is that that experience of slavery and even the longer one of capital, of colonialism, have created serious psychological scars and have left the people of the region and all those who are subject to colonialism totally dysfunctional.
Indeed, indeed. Let me
in their private lives and in their social lives.
Indeed.
So when we see
bring in Sister Aisha,
like where you have gender violence and so forth, all of that stems from that type of dysfunction.
Okay, let me bring in Sister Aisha now to talk about NAWS specifically. And as one of the founding members, along with Sister Josiane, and what was happening and what did NAWS do in 1970? What was the role that NAWS played in the 1970 Black Power Revolution? Let's start with Sister Aisha, and then we're going to bring Sister Josiane in right away to answer this particular question. Sister Aisha.
Yeah, and I kind of fell into NAWS as a person who was first introduced to the National Joint Action Committee. And being as young as I was tapped to get out there on the streets, essentially. You know, I would get dressed and go to school, and we wore the uniforms of our schools.
You were at Bishop's, is that correct?
Bishop Anstey High School, yes.
Right, and how many young people there participated in NAWS?
Bishop Anstey, maybe five at the most.
Five at the most. We know we had some from Woodbrook, and so on. So this is good. Bishop's Anstey, five. Okay, go ahead, my sister.
That's all right. And what was happening at the time during the state of emergency is that they were preparing to present the courts martial of the leaders of the coup that came out of the regiment at Tetron. And it was very clear to us as in Jack that something needed to be done. And it just so happened that the revolt, the speaking up about it coming from the young people was going to be strong and inspiring. That's how it was seen. And for some reason, that is what developed, and we went out into the street. I did not know Josiane originally because she lived in the South, and back that many years ago, the South was very far from the North. Now it isn't. And so when she came up, she went to Naps, and we met. It was immediate that we were fired up and inspired and acted as leaders and got on these soap boxes, literally got on boxes to stand so that we could be seen by the large crowds that were rallying around the issue of our soldiers being tried for what we believe was doing the right thing. Because what they were doing was speaking about justice and freedom and the truth of things that had not been spoken for many, many, many years in our country. And as Abu mentioned, as she mentioned, we're still headed to this freedom that we don't quite have, whether it is in Trinidad and Tobago or even globally for everybody of color, which everybody else has said today. So essentially, it was time to speak out, and the slogan was "Free our soldiers." And we got out there every day. Someone reminded us that the police not only were arresting us, but they were running after me to arrest me. They never quite caught me. But
yeah, we have a great historical pictures. The two historic pictures that really define that period of Noah's more than any others. There's that one of you sort of just barely escaping the clutches of a giant policeman in your uniform. And then there's one of Josanne with very skinny legs, I might add, in her school uniform with her power fist in the air leading a demonstration. Let me bring Josanne in to give us some more details about the that initiative to free our soldiers.
Well, before I talk a little more about that, I just kind of wanted to reinforce the fact that like a lot of the what was going on at the time, where people were coming from different perspectives, and I want to sort of underscore that while NOS would have been, because of my relationship through my dad and being in NJAC, and likewise Aisha and others, I won't speak for Martin and Chi and others, but there were students who were politicized in the school system that did not necessarily come to an organization that was the junior arm or the students of the National Joint Action Committee. I think credit and recognition must be given to these students. And who comes to mind? People like Gregory Bowrin and others who were meeting at his dad was a progressive lawyer, George Bowrin. And so they were meeting at Lenore's Business School in Woodbrook. Seiko Critchlow reminded me that all around in different schools, because young people were being impacted by that, this sort of seeking after something that was challenging the status quo. Remember, we were just 8 years after independence, and my father's generation and a little younger would have felt betrayed by the fact that independence did not deliver on that sort of self self-direction, et cetera, so that I think it's really very important to, while we talk about NOS, that we recognize that this organic sort of awareness and consciousness of young people and of our generation, I'm talking about our age group, did not necessarily, we didn't ignite them. They in fact added to the spark wherever that they were. You know, Martin could talk about what was going on at Woodbrook Secondary, where there were a lot of discussions taking place about the quality of the education system, what we were being taught, whether or not it was relevant. We also had teachers who were, in a sense, some more more visible than others from San Fernando. You had people like Winston Sweet and Wayne Davis, who were teachers at ModSec, Modern Secondary. And they were, in fact, encouraging that sort of progressive thinking. And those two brothers in particular ended up being suspended as teachers for 6 years. So the fact that we coalesced on the NOS was because by that time NJAC had become the more leadership organization, and people like myself and Aisha were already linked to NJAC. But I really wanted to say that we can't say that the consciousness of all of the students in the secondary school system that we were meeting with, that a lot of this was going on even before we sort of became the NOS, so to speak.
Let me just comment before you continue, but even while you're talking and the discussion is unfolding, we're already seeing the parallels to the present. There's so many things in what you're saying. I just want people to sort of, as they listen, to think about what's happening today with Black Lives Matter and see those parallels.
Yeah, and as we talk, and any of my, Aisha and Martin and thing, don't think that we have to wait for Shabaka to ask us something. Jump right in and sort of embolden or add something. Because I've raised that point about teachers, the sort of awareness. We didn't have the internet. We didn't have Instagram. We didn't have Facebook, but young people were inspired to read. Literature was there. And she made the point that even on the blocks in which people were not necessarily very well-schooled or formally schooled in a sense, that literature and discussions were taking place. And a lot of the people refer to it every year, come April 1970, people talk about that. The other thing I wanted to mention was, whilst we have seen post the 70 period, and not just in the Caribbean, where we've actually had to have governments and institutions push for quotas for women to be represented in politics, in the movement, and particularly in NOAS, because we're talking about NOAS, we had such a high percentage of young women involved. In other words, it wasn't us standing behind the men or the male students. When you look at the pictures and the memories, it's there. There's so many activists and so many young women who were, and it wasn't a discussion, well, okay, we have to have a quota balance, so we have to have a gender balance. Young women were as much involved and even more so sometimes in leadership, particularly in our NOAS environment, in the secondary school students environment. I remember sisters in NAPRIMA girls, I mean, it was kind of, yeah, it was the little leader kind of story, but I mean, we used to have all these discussions going on, and this was an all-girls school, an all-girls quote-unquote prestige school, or perceived to be prestige school. So I think that these are very important things to reflect on when we, if you will, compare, or if we try to mirror what is taking place and what has been taking place over the last 20, 30 years in terms of young people and their engagement. So I'd stop at that.
Yeah, let me just bring our brother Abu here in on this question, because Josan talked about the teachers who were sympathetic, and so on to the cause. But I imagine that there would have been those that were not sympathetic. And I want you to give me some sense of what happened in the environments where that was the case.
Okay, in the case of Woodbrook Secondary, which became the firestorm of the student movement in 1971, we have to understand that the whole question of the secondary school system came about with William's speech about the future of the country being in the school bags. And of course, they hustled and started building secondary schools. In fact, they didn't even have the land for some of the early schools, so that Woodbrook Secondary and Southeast Port of Spain were actually built on lands belonging to the city council where they were called market schools, because they were built on the old Woodbrook Market and the eastern end of the central market that was on Charlotte and George Streets. So what was quite interesting is that when we got into Woodbrook Secondary, I went in there in 1966, and these were buildings that were built with Inter-American bank loans. And the whole thing was basically shipped in parts and put together in Trinidad hastily. And the plumbing was, we are accustomed to what we call in Trinidad pipe, but that was faucet. So it took us quite a while to be able to get a drink of water, because we didn't understand how to operate a faucet at that time. Also, you had a shortage of staff for many, many subjects. I mean, they say we didn't see a physics teacher until we were in Form 4. And of course, what you had is the discussion among students about the inadequacies of the system, and also how relevant it was. Because one of the things that the nation was told is that once you got the five subjects, a job was waiting for you in the public service. Of course, we all realize that everybody cannot be in the public service. You need masons, carpenters, welders, many other disciplines. But that was because of their colonial attitude. They wanted to work in jacket and tie. So that was what was pushed by Williams, because he was a product of that. And as a result, we had a problem of supply and demand. So that,
yeah, but Brother Abu, I want you to bring me closer to what was happening in that period there.
Well, it was secondary.
I know we had that clash of ideas. We would have had the clash of ideas. I want to tell us how it played out in Woodbrook set.
Well, in Woodbrook secondary specifically, you had the lecture series by a lecturer from the University of the West Indies in late 1970 dealing with international relations. Of course, you would have dealing with questions like the Vietnam War and, of course, the wars in Africa and so on, liberation. Many of the members of staff started to get rather anxious about their charges becoming a bit radicalized. And they were also putting questions to many of these members of staff that they couldn't answer, because the students were reading a lot more, and they were reading on topics that, of course, their teachers were not okay around with. Of course, you had some young teachers who had recently come into the system who were, of course, part of the whole movement and so on. And they were also involved in discussions with the students. Of course, this led to students basically being banned from certain teachers' classes. Because
for the idea, so students back in 1970 in North were banned and kicked out of their classes because
well,
of their ideas.
Secondary, because of the well, in Woodbrook Secondary, it led to the whole of the fifth form being suspended. In fact, the question of they suspended the whole of the fifth form. And of course, there was the question of our being able to sit exams and what have you. But what happened is that students from
there were arrests also.
Yes, but this is what I'm coming to. Students of other schools came down in solidarity. Mm-hmm. So that is when I first met Josanne and Kirkland and Desmond Granger and so forth, and Dennis and these other guys. And when they came,
so the real bad students, so the real bad Johns in the whole thing, all the real came down when you all got into trouble.
Well, what happened is
to support you guys.
When they came and they supported, and of course we had a march and so forth, what happens is that students who belong to Woodbrook Secondary and those who came, some of them who came to support, were arrested. And they had a very, very terrible time at the hands of the police. Because here you have persons who are in Form 4, Form 3, some in Form 5. And of course, I know that Josanne, Kirkland, Boucher, who was from Woodbrook Secondary, I remember, they were arrested and taken to the Woodbrook Police Station. And they can tell you about what took place there, but we found out about it. And
one of the things,
you have adults who are so irresponsible to do what they did, because this transcends your job. You're talking about your own personal sense of morality. And what they subjected young persons to is, I mean to say, beyond ridiculous.
Yeah, I think this is another interesting parallel, brother. Let me bring in it, because we have a situation where we can see that the instinct is generally to demonize those who stand for change. We see that in the way that the authorities speak about those people who were protesting in the wake of the video emerging of the death, of the police killings of the brothers in Lavantil. We saw it
Shabaka, let me interrupt a little bit there, please. I want to take us back to Noah's a little bit.
Yeah.
If you all would permit. Because Noah's did not start in 1970, as far as I can remember. Noah's began in 1971, when the full leadership of the organization and Jack was in jail, good? Mm-hmm. And the whole question of arresting the soldiers and wanted to free the soldiers, that's when the students came out on the streets and said, free our soldiers. And that is the momentum upon which the NOS organization was built. Mm-hmm. You know, that would later take it down to, you know, other incarnations.
Correct, and you're
people,
very correct.
And people at some point might be wondering, where these mad little children come out from? You know, but we have to put that in the context of, in South Africa, when our elders there were drinking beers and rums, and I can't remember the name of the, what they call it, but the pubs then, but the children of Soweto were burning down those clubs, burning down those pubs, because their parents were not focused on what they should be focused on. And because our leadership at that time was in was incarcerated, and there was no one else outside to really pick up the thing in that kind of way, we had to fire the strength. We had to get the kind of passion to go outside there and let people know this thing has not ended as yet. And right, therefore, there are others coming behind, much like what Stalin said, 1,000 to come, or however the caliph so went. But that is how Noah's thing. But to get back to another point that Shabaka was raising, when he wondered how I got involved, you know, having these Chinese features and so on. So Brother Shabaka and others outside there, at every juncture of the organization, or the struggle, let me call it that, some individual or group of Chinese always involved. Always involved. Today, while we're doing this thing here, I'm seeing Tommy, I can't remember his surname. We always have some figure. So one of the figures, apart from Sekou and Kamau, who used to be called Derek Moses, and some of the other names we can't remember, there was one half Chinese girl named Poon, and her mm-hmm. father was also involved in the struggle, right? Yeah. So some, and then even in, among the soldiers, we had a Chinese soldiers.
Yeah.
So guys, we always involved yeah. simply because according to Mao Zedong at that time in the 70s, China is part of the third world and we are black.
I want to underscore something here from what she has said, because I don't, you know, we'll have many opportunities to be talking about Black Lives Matter and what's happening now. The important thing is to make the connection, to give people an understanding of what was taking place and the role of the things that young people were doing. And that point that she made is really very important, that when NOS came into its own, so to speak, was when there was no frontline leadership, as was known for NJAC. They were all incarcerated, and people also forget that we place so much emphasis on the first state of emergency, April 21, 1970, that we forget that they were released later that year. And then the following year in October, I think it was, there was a second state of emergency. And in between that, and I think this is the thing that I want to agree with Chi on, that of everything else that we were part of in terms of the politicizing, the awareness, the mobilization, being part of the whole movement for change, challenging the status quo in different ways, the thing that brought us together and thrust us, like the George Floyd scenario, thrust the Black Lives Matter movement into, catapulted into national and international recognition, was the Free Our Soldiers campaign. And I want to say, I was talking with Rafiq Shah earlier, and I want to recognize Rex LaSalle, who may be looking on tonight, 6 hours ahead, sitting in, hopefully, in Finland. He said he would make a point. The soldiers took a position that they would not allow themselves to be used to annihilate, to open fire to, because the directive was that they have to come into town. They have to come and quell what was going on, what was happening. And they took that conscious decision. And if I make a connection to now, it would be the ludicrous, uninformed statements about these men not deserving to wear a uniform, and that they are an abomination. Those 100 soldiers who were arrested and who took part in that mutiny, and the leadership of whom Rafiq was the youngest, him and Rex and Bazzi being Sandhurst trained soldiers. These were not jokers. These were not boys who needed to do what they did. They took a decision, notwithstanding the things that were happening within the regiment and all of those things, that they took a conscious decision that they were not going to be used in a way to the force and the firepower against the people of the country. And I think that is pretty significant when we think where we are today, not just in America, but where we are here in Trinidad. Yeah,
especially when we see sort of the readiness of our of some of our armed forces to take to point guns at people in the community who are protesting.
Well, we have to be.
But I want to ask another question here now. I want to bring in NUF, the National Union of Freedom Fighters, because when people think of the 1970s, they tend to think of that period of NJAC's reign between 1970 and perhaps 73, 74. And then they think of a younger generation in terms of NUF. They sort of forget about the role of NOS. NOS seems to be eclipsed by NUF in terms of people's memory. What was the relationship between NOS and NUF, if any?
Let me answer it quickly because I know you want to hurry up and get into the present. Somewhere in 1971, there was a group of people who were originally part of NJAC who thought that the struggle needed to be taken to the next level and it was time. Essentially, they were following what they saw happen in Cuba in 1960. And they thought it was time to militarize. And as some of us remember, they left NJAC, they armed themselves, they went up into the mountains and they decided to launch their attack. So their sallies from the mountains. And we don't have, as you all know, the types of mountains in Trinidad that others do in some of the larger Caribbean countries. So sadly, it did not take much, it didn't take long for them to be flushed out and several of them went to their deaths. But it was a break-off group that thought they were going to move it to the next level. It didn't turn out very well and the struggle continued. As it does today.
I wanted to say one thing,
I would like to come in at this particular point and to make a connection because you asked about NOS and what ended up with NUF. I mentioned when the students were arrested at Woodbrook Secondary and you had these students being basically carried through physical and mental torture at the Woodbrook Police Station. Here you had persons under the age of
18, 17.
So that they think is they're not adults. And Russian roulette was played on their heads by police in Trinidad.
Constable Duke.
Yeah. In fact, one of those who became part of NUF was Kirkland Paul.
And he was arrested and jailed at that time.
Later on, yeah, he was jailed together.
But was he part of that group at Woodbrook?
Yes, himself, Josanne, Boucher. I know about those three. And here you have youngsters being subjected to Russian roulette being played on their heads. This is no joking matter. And of course, what happened on the blocks was similar. Because men were being set up with false weed charges and what have you, and the police terrorized, and they took to the hills. A guy here who also went to Woodbrook Secondary ended up there. And I know the circumstances of, again, police harassment. Because here was a young black man living in Federation Park because his father was the head of the statistical office. And the police saw him coming home at night late and what is this young fellow doing, black boy doing in Federation Park and proceeded to give him a good curtail. And of course,
wow.
The second time it happened, he had his father's pistol. And that is what started the saga of Guy Harewood. Wow. So it is something that happened to many, many people. There are many stories of people they don't know their names. And the students, here you had secondary school students being subjected to that type of abuse.
Right, so that's a very interesting connection there. I'm so happy we had an opportunity to make that connection on this program today. This is really a historic moment in itself. This program is now starting to become very, very serious. So quickly, before we move on to the last segment, let's just get a quick run through of the flashpoints, the beginning to the end of NOS. When does NOS sort of dissolve and what happens to NOS at the end?
Okay, I think we have two, we have some incarnations here, and I don't like the beginning and the end, because as far as I'm concerned, there's continuity even to now. You know, it's not in the language, it's not in the thinking, okay, in my mind. I know what you're trying to get at, but sometimes I don't think that we should bring it down so simplistic and boxed-like, because then we don't continue to see the continuum. So you have the early, those of us who were in NJAC and others, and what culminated in NOAAS during the imprisonment or the incarceration, the state of emergency, where all of us more or less came together and NOAAS became the vehicle from representation from different schools, different districts. People were coming also from different sort of socioeconomic backgrounds, because there were people who were coming from bougie homes. There were people who were coming from very poor homes and poor communities. Then we went into that period, that very high point period of the Free Our Soldiers campaign. What would have happened to NOAAS and any of the progressives, including the Labour and NJAC, would have been as a consequence of what had happened in the country. By the time we had the second incarceration, the second state of emergency, and then that came out, there was the bust to the boom. We were going into the boom. Dr. Williams was very clever. He had started using the language of the revolution. In his convention in 1970, at the People's National Movement, he was talking about the need for revolutionary change and revolutionary ideas. So, whatever, and I'll let Chi and Martin, who would have survived myself and Asher in later incarnations of NOAAS. But the point is that what happened to NOAAS, or in terms of trying to put it in a box, would have been part of what would have happened in the overall society in terms of NJAC and the progressive elements in the society, because of what transpired. Some of us moved into other areas. My dad, for example, he and Rafiq got very involved in the mobilization of sugar workers and cane farmers. And that culminated in that horrific Bloody Tuesday march in 1975, on Coffee Street in San Fernando, which again mirrored kind of what we saw with NJAC and the movement preceding the NJAC, where you had clergy, you had students, you had activists, you had trade union leaders, sugar. So I think we do ourselves an injustice when we talk about something beginning and ending. I think it has different incarnations, so to speak, but we were at the effect of what was happening in terms of the repressiveness of the state, maybe the distractions too that were coming with the oil boom, the fact that Williams had started to do a lot of the things that the movement had called for in terms of nationalization and those kinds of things. And then many of us continue to operate in different spheres. So NOAAS, like my NJAC, still exists, and then it was rededicated under NJAC. And I think Chi and Martin could speak more to that.
Well, yes, one of the things that likewise what happened in the wider society that happened with the students, and many people are not aware of this, is that you had the conference at Chagaramas with Williams dealing with education. Correct. And the leadership of NOAAS at that time made a decision in that, of course, we were well known, we were considered rebels and what have you, and we decided that we would not attend the conference because we believed that Williams would not take our ideas on board. But what we did is that all of our ideas we sent with members of NOAAS who were from the prestige schools, those from St. Mary's, QRC, St. Joseph Convent, Holy Name. And they took the ideas to the student conference at Chagaramas with Williams. And out of that, the majority of our recommendations were taken on board. So you had the whole system of the comprehensive schools and so forth with the trade subjects and so on being taught. We also had, which took place in 1971-72, where you used to have private secondary schools. And of course, as time went on, they became less and less necessary, and some of them started to close down arbitrarily, and people had already paid their children's fees and what have you. And we marched against that, and we got the Ministry of Education to take in these students who were ready to sit exams. They had already paid their fees and so on. I remember a specific case with a school called Wong's. So all these are things that NAWS did that, of course, was not highlighted by the media. But there are many people today who were able to sit their GCE exams, and their parents were very, very happy for what NAWS did for them. So this is, we were able to impact the system in many ways.
Yes. Thank you, Brother Abu. I know Brother Kamo say he has come in.
Yeah, let me say something more about NAWS here. So NAWS did a couple other things apart from that. NAWS at one point tried to form a Caribbean Organization of Revolutionary Students. And we piggybacked on the elders in the movement who had the student groups and so on. So some of us traveled to Jamaica, to Grenada, St. Vincent, Barbados. I'm not too sure about Guyana as yet, but some of us traveled across. And at one point too, in Grenada, there was a guy named Murray, I don't remember his first name. He tried to join, or he was invited to join the conference. And he was told he's not black, he's white, he couldn't join the conference. And that had a big backlash here back in Trinidad and Tobago. In fact, the Express and all had an opinion on it. But apart from that, those other things that people might find ugly, NAWS also had its own publication. And for months upon months, we published work. And within that work, we were talking to students about what they need to do to understand what's going on and the kind of education they need to also involve themselves in and so on. And to let them know, more importantly, that politics is not only for the adults. Politics affect every facet of all of our lives. Don't the baby milk now, as we would know. So politics affect everything, and we're trying to help the students understand that this is what's going on. And then NAWS at one point evolved. Abu was the chair, and Seiko became the chair, and then Sundiata became the chair. And at one point, NAWS moved off the scene and morphed into something called National Youth Action Committee, which more reflected its youth part of the National Joint Action Committee. And struggles continued along that time. The whole question of the society and so on, we find that NAWS, let me say, as part of NJAC, part of the whole struggle, NAWS helped develop Trinidad and Tobago. We developed Trinidad and Tobago without using the public purse. We created, a sense of identity in people that is needed, We created a sense of self-worth at that time. And however, over the years, the state used our own funds to attack us and make us look so bad, especially during that period when we had the first oil boom, that people were overrun with money in some instances. And then when you push them to buy a liberation or a NAWS paper, it's like, I liberated already, and So consciousness began to retrograde. And somehow or the other, like if you're driving a car up a hill and it's tall and you roll back, it's not easy to start to go back up. And that's part of the problem. We have to find a way to adjust. Right?
Yeah.
So NAWS, those are different transition of NAWS and its contribution to social development. And the other thing too is that to all of us who are out there listening and so on, we need to try to develop in ourselves a sense of social consciousness, so that people will help change our perspectives and try to bring about the kind of society we're talking about, which is not just the political changes, but the changes in the minds that we will always talk about.
I would like to come in at this point.
Okay, wait, Brother Abu, because of our time, before we, I want to go to that question that Brother Chi raised there about these changes, because there's a new generation.
Well, that is specifically what I wanted to come in
on. I want to just ask one question before we go there. This is the last question, and we have to have a quick answer. One of the conversations that has come up in academia in particular about 1970, about that globally, about the Black Power Revolution, that period of upheaval, and particularly in African communities and in communities all across the Caribbean, is the role of women. and the experience of women in the struggle. And there are some academics who would argue that women were marginalized in the struggle. I just want to get a sense that, I want to get an answer from the women in particular before we move on to this next question. I know Josanne already said that NOAS, women were in the leadership of NOAS, but I also want you to speak to what you saw taking place in the National Joint Action Committee. Did you see women being marginalized, or was there, was part of the revolution?
Shabaka, I feel I should not allow that kind of question to go on.
I don't think, I too, I won't support it either.
You cannot allow that kind of thing to go on.
I'm not going to support answering that question either.
You can bring another question, Shabaka, please?
Yeah,
no, but I think it is important.
It's important.
This is a conversation. I am at the university forums, in the academic forums, and I'm hearing young people discussing these issues as if they know and they have experience. So now that I have you all,
but that's a question for NJAC and not for NOAS. Look, we have four NOAS people here, two women, two men.
Right, but that's what I'm asking you specifically.
Actually, Chi, I think now we have gone a little far, because if you notice, and you haven't heard anything about me for about between 6 and 9 months, I was involved. Let's argue that I aged out, but every leader that was mentioned after by Abu was male. I am going to say this, that was not accidental, but today it doesn't need to be expressed, and we have to deal with what's happening currently that we're going to try to tie in. It was an issue, but I think we have got to go ahead and talk about what the young people, male and female, are doing today.
I also want to say something too. I never like to have discussions where, in part of helping to lift the veil, that we go down the road of being the devil's advocate, or we look for the things that, okay, academic discussions, I don't give a flying foot about academic discussions, because the reality on the ground and what people's lives are, that kind of indulgence, if in a different setting, I think we can have that discussion. But I don't think today that I personally want to make those kinds of pronouncements about NJAC and this and that, because not sufficient enough people have an appreciation, an awareness, an understanding of what happened during that period of change and social awareness and fight for social justice. And was it perfect? No. Was there gender imbalance? Yes. But I don't think that that's the discussion today at all, and I'm not going to support it.
Okay. I will come in here at this point.
Right. And I also want to get up. I know, because we're live, but I need to put on a light because my light is a little dim now. So I'm just going to get up. Yeah. And I'm just going to put on a light.
Why are you getting up? Right. I'll make a point here. Brother Chi had mentioned it, and it is very important. One of the things that came out, because NOAS was very active with the young people who are today 60, let us say 55 to 65. And one of the impacts NOAS had is that, you see, all of those young people who are out there today that are age 30-something, that are named Kwesi and this and that, and with African names, that is because of NOAS. While the main leadership was locked up, the students carried the whole of the struggle.
Yeah,
the students are the ones who were out there interacting with those who were their peers. And it is the work of the students that you see reflected in today, many young people having braids because of the work that we were doing with them. They became the parents.
Okay.
And they named their children with African names and so forth.
Thank you, brother. It was good to know that NOAS contributed to all these things. So now I'm really inviting audience participation now to ask questions. I'm gonna try as much as possible to deliver those questions to our panelists. But I also want to start to bring us now to the contemporary. This is the last segment of our show. So one of the things that I think one of the defining features of the global revolt right now is the deep cross-section of all races in the revolt right now. I think you had that in 1970 to some extent, but I think it's gone to a whole different level now. I just want anybody want to comment on that? Brother Chi, Brother Abu, Sister Josan, she's not back in with us yet.
Rebecca, I was distracted a little bit. Can I get that question again, please?
Right. I'm saying that we're now talking about what's happening now, this global revolt against white supremacy and racism. And one of the features of this particular time, I grew up in a period where the one struggle that was illegitimate in the world, the one human rights struggle that was illegitimate, was the struggle for racial justice. You could fight for everything else, and you would be considered a respectable human rights effort. But the struggle for racial justice was something that was seen as illegitimate, something that should have remained something from the past that wasn't necessary in the present, and so on. All these kinds of mythologies around it. Now you see the whole world waking up to the struggle for racial justice, and it being joined, so many whites in particular, Europeans joining with people of other races, Chinese, Japanese, Koreans, people from India and Africa, in the struggle for racial justice. I want people to comment on that. What has led to, in your opinion, that difference, that force among the allies, so to speak, that coming together that we see now?
I would say one thing that drives the whole of it, and that is technology. In 1969-1970, your main medium of communication would be through newspapers. It would be the telephone. But in the period of the Gulf War, we saw a very interesting thing happen. People would be sitting down and watching in the night on the television. And a guy would be able to sit down in Israel and see this Scud missile that is coming towards. And he can actually know if it is going to pass his village. So he is actually watching the war live on television.
The revolution will be televised.
Everything is live. So that there were atrocities that were a lot worse than flying. But the thing is, no one saw it. But now, the whole world saw it.
Let
me just jump in for a moment. Actually, you are absolutely right. On the other hand, we did not have the kind of conscious participation by the English-speaking white people or white people anywhere that we do now. And that is an important stage of this continuum that Josanne talks about. It is true that now everything is live and in real time, and we are seeing all over the world the movement that has developed, and we can see how many people who are of a privileged race, white, who are joining and recognizing that there is no way around the fact that white supremacy is the problem. Back in the 70s when we were marching, I will not admit that white people were willing to step out of their privilege and do that work. And so that is one growth, because
one difference, definitely. Brother Chi, you wanted to come in?
Hang on, a critical mass is what will make the difference to the kind of change that we actually want to see.
So we have had lots of instances, and I'm told I'm sounding like I'm quarreling. Believe me, I'm not quarreling, guys. We have lots of instances of black people, African people in particular, in the US, who are just brutalized, shot, and you know, nobody hears about it except the news people, one day headline and so on. However, with the George Floyd issue, as much as people tried to say how bad he was and so on, the brutality and the savagery of what happened with George Floyd could no longer, especially just broadcast live, because, you know, according to Granny and the CNN's believing, when you get them a story, they hear the story, but when they see it, the savagery of it, you know, it kind of picked whatever little conscience they have, and that began to think. Similarly, like we here in Trinidad and Tobago, recently, with the shooting in Mova right here, good? We, you know, the police would always say they fired at us and we fired back at them. If that video hadn't taken up what was taking place there, we'd have had a similar story where they fired at the police and the police fired back and so on. Mm-hmm. So sometimes, it is a question of the immediacy of seeing anything and seeing where what is truth and what is not truth that fired up people's imagination, people's consciousness, and people's sense of injustice being taken care of against. Mm-hmm. And let me just say too. Across the world, we're talking about Black Lives Matter. And that is important. However, in countries like us where we have Black leadership and Black in all the top positions, we gotta say, poor Black lives matter. Poor Black lives matter. You know, and appeal to the sense of, you know, decency in some people to address these issues like that, you know. We in our, what they like to call depressed communities and disenfranchised community, we check up the meaning of those words, its ordinary meaning, and then apply it in the way it's supposed to be applied to us here, we're going to have a different sense of what we're talking about when we talk about disenfranchised communities and so on. We really left out. We really left behind. Behind God, back says Granny and them what to say. So, mm-hmm. Let's go ahead. Sorry.
Yeah. Thank you, brother. And let me just say that you're not sounding like you're quarreling. We appreciate very much your input, my brother. Sister Josanne, let me bring you in here to sort of help us connect, to continue that connection that Brother Abu started, Sister Aisha continued, and Brother Chi also continued, that connection between the past and the present.
Well, you know, the connection has many different tributaries. The one thing I want to say, which probably might put me at odds with everyone else, is that it's this sense of people's conscience being pricked and coming out is all wonderful. But, you know, I think that unless the sympathizers and the allies are ready to confront, particularly when we're talking about Black Lives Matter and the global thing where it's a white, Black, white supremacy, all of these things, that the issue of what is fundamentally at the core of whether it's police brutality, systemic racial injustice and the rest of it, it's the fact that the issue of reparations and the issue of the condition of African people in particular has not been addressed. So that it's all nice and feel good and we could all lock arms and walk down. That's wonderful. But white privilege, and whites and the people who have benefited have to take the conversation beyond the marching and the solidarity, because they live lives that have benefited from this systemic eradication of a whole set of people over hundreds of years. And I think that if we're not prepared to do that, then it's a kind of a feel good. It's a kind of feel good.
Okay, but more than that,
Josanne, it amongst what Malcolm X would say, as soon as the white people join the struggle, they water, they come like a black Sorry. Coffee, they put up a milk in it, it just waters it down. So now we no longer want to recognize what the white man has been doing to us. Now we want to embrace him and say, welcome to the struggle, brother. And after two days, that's the end of it.
That's a real important point. But I think today, and that's why we needed to make this transition and talk about what is happening today. Mm-hmm. You are right, that can happen. But what is happening globally is that Black people are clear, people of color are clear that they will retain control of their struggle and that white allies may assist. But we are very, very clear about not allowing folk who are steeped in privilege, who hold privilege, to take over. And that has got to be the key every day as a conscious effort, because you are right. Somebody said, you know, it's a matter of our minds. Our minds in many ways are still enslaved. We are experiencing and continue to experience historically internalized oppression. And we sometimes can be our worst enemies if we don't daily remind ourselves of the work to be done, that we must never get lazy about it and be at the forefront of it, that we must never concede it to anybody as hard as it is. We do not give it to anybody to do. They may join us. They may give us some of that privileged money, which Lord knows we need, but we will lead our struggle. And that's got to be clear.
Right.
Shabaka, I'd like to say something in the context of the Trinidad and Tobago / Caribbean situation. I saw any number of posts, but I saw a post from a young sister who's, I'm not going to call her name. She's very well known to a lot of people, particularly as a kind of hip rasta. And she made the point that until the George Floyd situation, which everybody wanted to get on, it evoked and provoked and what have you, that the same people who were prepared to march and pontificate here, and I'm talking about America now, I'm talking about here, about injustice, because essentially it comes down to injustice, whatever the root cause is, it's there, that nobody was saying something about the young man who was manhandled at the university, was it last year or year before, when they were, the students were having their protests there. And I have seen a very, maybe there's fear, but we were sharing some amongst ourselves that last week Tuesday, and a girlfriend of mine, I was saying, I sat in this apartment of mine and I cried like a baby when I saw what was taking place in Border Spain. And I was, the emotion was, it morphed to anger because I belong in it to a number of chat groups. And the common feeling that I was getting was that these people were saying, yes, but them criminals and them, you know, it's almost like they deserve to be treated like that. It didn't resonate that we, the collective we, have created a society where there's such inequity, where there's so much underdevelopment, where there's so much lack of opportunity, so that it's nice and good when we could walk and, you know, put up big placards and say Black Lives Matter. But when it comes to recognizing in our environment, these communities in which we have allowed, as Rafiq Shah pointed out last week in his column, you move shantytown from one side of the Labas to the next side. We stop calling it shantytown and we call it Beetham Gardens. We gentrified it. But we continue to prescribe for that community a sense of their value being the living essentially that they eke out of the Labas, the landfill, the nice gentrified name, the landfill. We also forget that in terms of these groups in a society is that we've had a drug economy here, and that young predominantly Afro-Trinidadian males, predominantly, were the enforcers, were the runners, were the whatever it is. The trade has become very legal. People have cleaned themselves up, very gentrified. And there's a vacuum. We've not the opportunities for education, the opportunities, or give them a little 10 days.
Yeah, but let me ask a pertinent question here, because the same kinds of nasty attitudes to the protesters today would have been voiced by the same class about the protests that you all were engaging in 1970. And maybe you could tell those young people now who are on the streets today, who are the victims of that kind of this, maybe you could give them some insight in terms of how they should proceed in the face of this contempt. Because I've heard the comments too, eradicate them, bomb the whole place, you know, wipe out the pests. I mean, these are some, I just write Nazi in chat groups when I see things like that. I identify them as what I call Nazi comments. So maybe you could say something coming from that period where Chi, yourself, Aisha, Abu, you all would have been the ones who would have been condemned and criticized in that vulgar manner back in the 1970s. What can you say to young people today who are on the
show? Let me start a discussion, please, guys.
Yes.
And I kind of want to take it and respond to someone who was asking, what should the future of education look like now? Good. And the person was asking, if we should have smaller classrooms and that kind of thing. The education we talk about, we glibly use the word education to mean the academic and the whole question of, the whole question of this subject, that subject, and so on. We need more social education in this country so that we can tell our people how to have pride in themselves, how to have self-confidence in themselves, what they must do, what we must do, how we must exhibit these things. Another thing about the education system, I always say, is that the governments of the day, they provide a school house, they provide some teachers, whether the teachers care or not, they provide those teachers. And back home in our homes, when we go home or when we leave to go to school, we don't have the nourishment. In fact, we fill bellies in our communities that don't nourish our bodies, you know.
And our minds. Yeah.
And we need to get our... Yeah.
Let me ask you this question now, related to the contemporary movement. One of the things that young people have done in this particular incarnation of struggle is quickly turn to the racists and white supremacists on the plinths in their hometowns and pull them down as a stepping stone for the kind of future that they want to create. Anybody want to comment on that? Because you talk about the way where the public social education that we need to be involved in, that is a form of public or social education, is it not?
I want to stay a little bit more on what I was kind of talking about. If I'm seen as indisciplined, let me know and I will shut up.
But no, you talk, brother.
This is your name.
I want to say a little bit on it, right? Because many times we hear people talk and they condemn our parents. They condemn our parents and say the parents ain't taking care of the children, not realizing that the way the society is organized, lots of our parents from our communities, I'm talking about in Mova, Lavantil, Kokori, them back there down south, and the Mang down Princess Town, and all of these communities, our parents have to work 2 and 3 jobs per day. And so they're not home to even help us. And then the whole question of our parents being children themselves, you know, and we dismiss these kind of conditions we exist under and just try to further denigrate the other generations as they come. In fact, tomorrow somebody might even be talking about something that happened, trying to understand what that individual, what that family has been going through. So we really need different agencies of the state to seriously, you know, up their ante in terms of dealing with the social problems that we face here, understanding what is really education. Is it just getting our 5 passes? You know, is it really that? Because I am saying here, I spent 5 years in Belmont Secondary, and when I left school, I did not get a single pass, and a lot of my so-called subjects had U on them, and I never knew what U meant until years later. I understand, you did so poor, so bad, they couldn't grade you, and therefore U meant you weren't graded. You know,
you could have gotten a job as a senior or starlight.
I can't hear what you say, but we need to have those issues, you know, addressed in our communities, and it's not because I didn't want to achieve in school. But for example, like, and this is not about me, but I just know that thousands of children go to school today in the same conditions I went to school way back then. Yeah. I went to school with 1 textbook that all granny could have afforded to buy for me, you know? And every time I had to change a copy book, she vexed because she had to find money to buy another copy book, not realizing there's 5 and 6 subjects going at 1 copy book.
And we like to come in here.
State must recognize these things. We all must recognize these things and try to encourage discussion and action to address these issues.
Yes, I think that's a good place for us, Brother Abu. Unfortunately, I'm getting the signal now from the director, the chairman of the Emancipation Support Committee, that my time is up. So we're gonna have to leave it there. But I want to say that that's a great place for us to end. That passion and concern that the members of the National Organization of Revolutionary Students still maintain, that fire that burns for the sufferers, the people in the most difficult circumstances in our society today, that still remains part of the ethos and the thinking of our people.
So Shabaka, give us a 30 seconds so we could think, so you don't speak for us.
I'll give you all a quick last minute wrap up here. Go right ahead. Everybody gets a chance to wrap up.
Okay, so I think that what we have to do going forward is to understand that we need to adjust our own thinking. If we want to talk about ending the chain, moving the chains of our minds, we have to deliberately decide to change our thinking so that we can help the younger generation move forward the way we think they should move forward. Well, we'd like them to move forward, let me see.
Uh-huh. Sister Aisha?
Yeah, it's really important that we recognize the work that is happening today, that the leaders of this work globally are young people, that they have a clear sense of where they need to be going. And let us also remember, it ties into everything that the other panelists are saying, that the issue of classism is where a lot of this lies. Because, for instance, I went to one of those prestige schools as mentioned in some of the questions, but it was doing the struggle secretly. And please remember Dr. Olabisi Kuboni, who's just retired from the University of the West Indies, was actually a teacher at Bishop Anstey High School teaching French and secretly supporting us and doing the work. So it's very hard in some of these quote unquote, don't like the term, prestige schools, but the work was being done and the teachers were involved. And I just want to say what we have done here today ought not be the end of this conversation. We've got to take it further.
Thank you. Brother Abu, I'm going to give
you... What we are witnessing at this point in time is part of that continuing struggle of our people trying to unyoke themselves from the burden of colonialism.
Yes, indeed.
Just a continuing step.
Yes,
of people trying to unyoke ourselves.
Yes, Sister Josanne.
I just like really, really before we go off to say thank you to my fellow contributors. It's been a wonderful sort of reconnecting. We came, we did our work in our time. The struggle continues, as they say. If I have to say to all of Trinidad and Tobago and anyone who is looking on the program, COVID-19, which affected the entire world, has shown even more glaringly the gross inequities that exist. And for us, I think if there's a takeaway or something that I would like to see us focus on, is that we have to recognize the inequalities and inequity in our communities, and that the education system is broken. It promotes educational injustice, and that leads to so many other things. For those of us who are part of the intelligentsia, I'll end on a Fanon quote, which is, each generation must, out of relative obscurity, discover its mission, fulfill it, or betray it. I think the four of us could say that we did our best to fulfill our mission. And thank you all so much for being a part of this discussion.
Thank you indeed. And I tell you, it was a real pleasure to have the opportunity to speak with each and every one of you, to share this time today. I know our audience feels the same. Let me just say quickly, I have, a few seconds left, that, for too long, we've asked our citizens in this country to adapt to unacceptable situations of disadvantage instead of addressing their critical needs. I think each one of you all spoke to that. And I want to point out, in keeping with Uncle Chief there, that none of our politicians, none of the middle class commentators would want to have their children go to the schools that serve the children in the hotspot communities, even though they need it more than anybody else. So this is this conversation is something that is ongoing, and we certainly have to continue the work to create the kind of equity and kind of society that we want to see in the future. I want to invite everybody to join us next week, Thursday, that's the 16th, at 5:30 for another discussion, the next in the series. I think that's where the children of the revolution will be featured. Now, which one was that going to be? Okay, we're gonna make that stuff public in the future. But now let me just thank our those who supported this virtual event. That's the UWI Open Campus, and of course the Ministry of Community Development, Culture, and the Arts. This has been the second edition of the Kwame Ture Memorial lecture series. And of course, the theme today was 1970, Remembering, Reconnection, and Recommitment. Thank you, Josan. Thank you, Chi. Thank you, Brother Abu. Thank you, Sister Aisha. And thank you to all of those who joined us here on Facebook and, of course, on Zoom. Please take the opportunity to share wildly, as widely as possible, so that these messages and these ideas can get out. Thank you very much. Say it now.